A lot of people don't get to see the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic firsthand. This pandemic must be seen. That's an article from Wired, and it explains why people need to see the images of COVID-19 patients and the exhausted healthcare workers on the front lines to grasp how serious the pandemic is. Roxanne Khamsi, who wrote the piece, is with us now to talk about what we're seeing and not seeing here in the United States. Roxanne, thanks so much for being with us. In your piece, you reference a video posted by a COVID patient from England, and she's coughing violently and asking people to take this disease seriously because she doesn't want people to get sick like she has gotten sick. But a quick social media search turns up posts saying it's a hoax. How are people watching these videos and drawing the conclusion that they're actors or it's fake?
Yeah, I mean, I think that that was a terrible outcome from that video because there was a woman who had posted to say that she was ill, and then her family started to get attacked because people thought it was fake. And my big wish is that this pandemic not become out of sight, out of mind, because as a reporter, I've been writing on and off about coronaviruses since 2004. And for me, it really took seeing videos of patients suffering to understand what we're dealing with here.
Yeah, you know, one of our correspondents, David Begno, he did a piece a couple of months ago where there was a woman who was actually tracking herself in the hospital who ultimately passed away. And it was just heartbreaking to watch her go from being relatively healthy to getting sicker and sicker and sicker. And you write that your first inkling that this virus was going to be serious came to you when you watched a video of a Chinese doctor screaming in a break room. Describe what you saw and how you knew that it was a sign of things to come.
I mean, by that time, I had been reading for about 3 weeks about this mysterious pneumonia that was affecting people in Wuhan, and it was late night on Twitter. These things crop up on social media, and the problem is we can't always know the provenance of them. I know that as people in the news, you're very focused on finding out who films these things, so I didn't share the video, but it really launched me into taking this pandemic much more seriously because the scream that this woman had, and I don't know if she was a doctor or a nurse, I know she was purportedly a medic, it shook me really to my core. And it's going on right now in terms of the overload at hospitals. Healthcare workers are stretched so thin, and at the same time, we're talking about Thanksgiving recipes and kind of going about our lives as, I mean, not normal, but we don't see this on a daily basis. And for me, as somebody who deals with science all the time, it really took that personal that video of a person to bring it home.
Yeah, I mean, it's something that I've said, you know, throughout the course of this pandemic that, you know, the notion, and I know it's hard for people to imagine because people want to see images and people want pictures, and you rightly point out in the news business, in the broadcast news business, we always say we want pictures, we want to see what's going on, it's a visual medium. But it, for me, just knowing the number, and I don't know why, you know, I suspect there are more people like me. When you use a number like 252,000 Americans who have succumbed to this virus, all I do is I look at the number of people we lost, for example, in the Vietnam War, 58,000. And you are now looking at numbers that go so far beyond that. And I've said this frequently on the air. The Vietnam War, you know, I grew up in the wake of that war. It scarred this country enormously to have lost the flower of our youth in fighting a war that many people felt we didn't need to fight. And now you're talking about 250,000 dead, and people see the images, and they're still numb to it. And as you say, they become exhausted over seeing the images over and over again in the news. What have you found has led to that?
I mean, I'm definitely not a media critic. I'm a science journalist, so I can only speak to my personal point of view, which is I grew up in an age where there was a lot of rhetoric about anti-smoking. And, you know, you could hear that, like, X number of people died a year from smoking. But until I saw the lung of somebody who had been smoking and I saw how blackened it had been, that for me, I remember I was, you know, like 8 or 9 years old, that brought it home for me. Likewise, you know, there are images of lungs scarred by COVID, and they are worse, I think, than even smoking. Yeah. So I think imagery really can drive home what numbers maybe can't. And you're right, numbers are staggering. Numbers do make us wake up to this. But I think we need both numbers and imagery to convince people that it's not a hoax and it's something that can really affect their health.
Yeah, the other thing that I, for me specifically, even as a reporter, what sort of drove it home for me in the early days of the pandemic was, you know, seeing images of medical professionals, doctors, nurses, and even cafeteria workers who were working in these hospitals, and you would see them, you know, some of them crying, some of them with their faces scarred by the PPE that they were wearing, and that really took me back, because you rarely ever see the medical professionals looking the way that they did in trying to treat patients. And we saw that a little bit in China. Some of the images that we saw of people that were sickened were really, really very shocking. And people that were struggling to breathe. Did that sort of drive it home a little bit more for Americans in your reporting? Did you discover that?
I think that what you're pointing to is a real interesting point, which is the imagery has evolved over the course of this pandemic. And we're actually really not seeing right now a lot of photos like we did in March of healthcare workers, you know, with the marks on their face of the masks, kind of because they've been wearing them all day and how exhausted they are. So I think first and foremost, we're just not seeing so much of that anymore, even though we know by the numbers that the pandemic is actually kind of growing worse and worse and worse as we're heading into winter. But I do think that some of the imagery from Wuhan in the early days, you know, Fang Bing was a person who went in and took some videos inside hospitals of patients, then had disappeared. So, you know, there was more of an insight into what was going on to hospitals. I think we rightly have privacy laws here that prevent that sort of thing from happening. I mean, television journalists aren't racing into hospitals to take photos of patients without anyone's consent, which I think is a good thing. But I think we could be doing more to elevate the voices of people who are video casting from their bedside and showing us what it really is like to be gasping for air because you can't breathe.
It's an excellent point. The other thing that I also remember, which was absolutely haunting and chilling, was in the darkest days of the pandemic here in New York City, just hearing the constant sound of sirens. I mean, you just I mean, there are sirens on any good day in New York City. It's a big city, you know, of 8 million people, but you just heard them constantly throughout the night and day. I'd never heard anything like that in my life. And then we saw images of trucks that, you know, were being used as sort of makeshift morgues and to store bodies. We saw a hospital that was set up in Central Park. That seemed to drive it home for a lot of folks in this city, which is, you know, and subsequent to that, this city has been able to keep the numbers relatively low. We're seeing an uptick now. But, you know, I don't know if that was the same experience that other people had in other parts of the country or in rural areas where perhaps sirens are not as prevalent as they would have been here. But you're right that in hearing those things and seeing some of those images, they certainly changed my perspective. I mean, if anything, I became more paranoid about, like, you know, I was disinfecting, like, you know, groceries and takeout containers, which, of course, doctors say isn't really necessary. But that's how, but that imagery and that sound that just was a constant, you know, made me really, really worried about my health and that of my wife.
Yeah, I think you're making a great point where cities had the density, where you had, it was not just a thing that you read about, but you were hearing it. You heard the sound of alarm, whereas in places that are populations are more dispersed, you don't really get that same effect. And so I think that, you know, just to go back to what I was trying to say earlier about, like, we're human beings at the end of the day. And we have these senses that really have to be engaged in order for the communication about the gravity of this pandemic to really come home, I think. And you guys are doing a great job covering this. And I think that we just need to keep the spotlight on what's going on in hospitals, because our tendency is to, you know, get distracted by the election or, I mean, it's no longer an election, but we human beings don't like to think about these things because it's hard and it's sad. But at the end of the day, it's people's lives, it's moms, it's dads, and, you know, family members and hospital workers, essential workers. So I think we need to keep the focus on.
One last question, Roxanne, because you mentioned that you're a science reporter. I'm curious about your personal perspective when it comes to writing about science and interviewing and talking to people who don't believe in the science or who think it's fake or who even think that the images that you're showing them are fake, because it just makes me, you know, you know, we didn't need to see a Nazi in our backyard to know that we were fighting Nazis in Europe and in the Pacific and in other parts of, you know, or the Japanese Imperial Military. We didn't need to see them in our living rooms to know that they were a real threat. We weren't on the moon when Neil Armstrong walked there. We looked at images and we said we sent a man to the moon. Is it harder for you to do your job if you are writing from a science-based perspective, but you're dealing with people who deny the science?
That's a great question, and I think it's a very 2020 question, because we're living, obviously, in this disinformation, misinformation age, and I find that, you know, as I said, I've been writing about at least coronaviruses since 2004, and I can promise you that back then we didn't have the same level of it's a hoax kind of people saying that kind of thing. So I think that things have changed. At the same time, I also think that a virus like this is scary, and people don't like to be afraid. So they will kind of steer their minds into something that's less scary. And so I think we need to find ways to make people understand what's going on, but not scare them. So I think as a science communicator, I really try not to frighten people, but just to help them understand how something so small as this tiny virus can lead you to feel like you are drowning on land because your lungs filled with fluid. So it's the reality, and I don't think we should look away.
I mean, I don't know, but sometimes being scared seems to work. I mean, you're absolutely right. My stepdad was a longtime smoker, smoked his entire life. We couldn't get him to stop. And finally, when a doctor showed him a picture of his lungs, he quit that day. I mean, that was, you know, it was enough to sort of strike, you know, the fear into him that his days were numbered if he continued down that path. And so I don't know. Sometimes a little fear is what keeps us. You know, I've joked about this before, Roxanne, but, you know, it was the fear of getting eaten by a saber-toothed tiger that probably kept my ancestors in the cave when the other idiots decided to go out for a party and didn't come back. And so my gene pool is still here and viable in 2020s, and theirs is not. That's the way I like to look at it.
Right. Absolutely.
Roxanne Khamsi, thank you so much. Really great talking to you. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Vlad. Thanks for having me.